driving force behind so many unfairness within Jehovah's Witnesses organization, right since the beginning. In this video we will verify the most horrible double standards inside Jehovah's Witnesses. Let's talk about their first president, Charles Taze Russell. Well, first of all, he was not the first president. The Watchtower Society lies when Taze Russell is the first president. In fact, their first president was William Henry Conley between 1881 and 1884. Charles Taze Russell just replaced him when Conley stepped down. However, Russell's life wasn't full of virtues. As soon he grew old, he started to get involved in polemics and several accusations were raised against him. We won't talk about allegations of adultery. Once it seems that it was a misunderstanding which led to a slander. Charles Taze Russell admitted to be a Freemason. In San Francisco Masonic Center he stated that, "I am now a free and accepted Mason. I guess we all are." Despite some people saying that he was using rhetoric. Such excuse is nonsense once he wouldn't place himself as being part of something so unholy, unless he was really part of it. He also used plenty Masonic imagery in Jehovah's Witnesses publications. Some of them were actually taken from the occult Hermetic orders, whose leaders were Freemasons, just like him. The term Watchtower and its symbol as shown in the cover of the earlier Watchtower magazines, have both its roots in magic, being found, for example, in the tarot cards. Russell also promoted the occult belief that God's heavenly residence is in the star Alcyone, in the Pleiades constellation. As can be found on the original Watchtower of the 15th of May 1895 and repeated by the 1st of December 1896, and by 1904 in page 618 of his book, The New Creation. Such false belief was later repeated by Joseph Rutherford, his replacement as president of the Watchtower Society. This is not only a 33-degree Masonic belief, but such star is also used in Spiritism. As the path of energy of life, Charles Taze Russell, neither Joseph Rutherford was censored, warned neither excommunicated for promoting such blasphemous teachings. But what about the second president of the Watchtower Society, Joseph Franklin Rutherford? Rutherford didn't have a good start as president. First of all, he promoted a civil war inside the organization. Between those who followed Russell and those who supported him. Despite Rutherford not being a Freemason, he was the man of the Masons inside the Watchtower. That might explain why his reign was dictatorial and marked by rudeness and other several abuses. His first step immediately after being elected president was to split from his wife. According to the Bible principles, an overseer must be married to one woman only, and the divorce should be only granted for the reason of porneia, which means adultery. As far as we know, his disabled wife maintained herself faithful to Jehovah's Witnesses organization, which makes it unlikely that she had given such biblical reason for divorce. This issue makes him completely unqualified for the post he held. On the other hand, rumors of an affair with his personal nurse were coming up so often that even the press gave notice of it. Rutherford had also an alcohol problem. According to Walter Salter, the then overseer of the Canadian branch, Rutherford forced him to smuggle loads of beer, whiskey and liquor in order to satisfy his alcoholic vice. This was during the Prohibition, in which the production and trade of alcoholic beverages were banned in the U.S. territory. Other important officials complained, not only about his alcohol abuse, but also the rude treatment to which Rutherford's servants were subjected. As outcome, instead of Rutherford being removed, reproached or censured, the accusers Walter Salter and Olin Moyle were DIS fellowshipped. which resulted in a legal action against the Watchtower Society. Olin Moyle was awarded $15,000 in compensation. Rutherford had also a pornography problem, which was raised by George Fisher, another member of the Watchtower Board of Directors. According to Fisher, Rutherford had attended to an erotic show in the Apollo Theater in New York. This was by the year of 1925. In 1926, Fisher strangely died of heart attack and the subject was forgotten. After all this, we cannot forget that Rutherford was the Watchtower Society president who instructed attendants to reply back with violence against violent mobs who were disrupting their conventions. The attendants were fully authorized by Rutherford to spank the mob members with baseball bats, which is something biblically unacceptable. Don't forget also that Rutherford was the one who publicly criticized Hitler for banning the Freemasons from Germany. As a response, Hitler started a brutal campaign against all the Jehovah's Witnesses, sending them to the death camps in which several of them were murdered. Once he understood that Jehovah's Witnesses had the full support of that diabolical secret society, to whom Hitler understood as a threat and corrupting. Don't forget that in the end of World War II, Hitler was defeated by American and British generals who all of them were Freemasons. Dwight Eisenhower was not a Freemason, but he had been educated as a Jehovah's Witness until the age of 21. Both his parents were baptized Jehovah's Witness, and very close to Charles Taze Russell. Now it's time to talk about the third president, Nathan Knorr. Nathan Knorr was far more discreet and less polemical than his predecessor. Nathan Knorr was a huge organizer and his ideas usually had brilliant results. He was the mastermind behind the strong biblical education and mind control to which Jehovah's Witnesses are subject until today. He created the Biblical School of Gilead, which was used to train missionaries in order to spread the word of God all around the world. But at the very same time, graduates of such school were invited to become Freemasons with the intention of spreading the Anglo-Saxonic Freemasonry all over the planet. This Freemasonic connection might be the explanation why Nathan Knorr was so tolerant to homosexuals and pedophiles inside Jehovah's Witnesses organization. Mostly if they were high officials such as Leo Kincaid Greenlees, who despite having a homosexual relationship with Percy Chapman, and later with a young Be the Light named Lorne Bridle, who committed suicide after a failed marriage with a Canadian pioneer sister, Greenlees was called to work in Brooklyn Bethel by the year of 1964. Being promoted to the board of directors 1 year later, and became automatically member of the governing body in 1971. Nathan Knorr knew that Leo Greenlees and Chapman were homosexuals, but only intervened when Chapman's case became public. Knorr also knew that Greenlees and Theodore Jarach were pedophiles, but under the lodge recommendations he had to cover up their crimes. Because all of them were Freemasons, Knorr also knew that Ewart Chitty, the secretary treasurer of the British Bethel, was a homosexual, having himself a romance with a roommate with whom he shared the room for more than 30 years. But despite being aware of it, Knorr personally invited Chitty to become part of the newly formed governing body in 1974. Ewart Chitty was removed from the governing body by the year of 1979, 2 years after Knorr has died. When he was allocated in Brooklyn Branch in 1974, he showed his preference for young good-looking males to share his room. However, not all of them were enthusiasts of his homosexual tendencies, which resulted in several complaints for his inappropriate approaches to other males. After Nathan Knorr had died, the complaints were properly investigated, and it was understood that Chitty was not qualified to be a governing body member, and had to be removed. However, he was allowed to remain in Brooklyn Bethel as an elder, being removed and sent back to the British branch after reports that he succumbed to heavy drinking. After he returned to London, he received an assignment of lower responsibility, and was still assigned as an elder to a local congregation where he remained until his death in 1993. But that is not everything. We have for a fact that Knorr was a Freemason, and received specific instructions to cover up homosexuality inside Jehovah's Witnesses, which was infiltrated in there by the Freemasons. For example, in 1969, Honest Jehovah's Witnesses reported to their leadership that the sauna rooms were used for the practice of homosexual orgies, in which hundreds of males were participants. After a strong persistence of other members of the governing body, Knorr finally authorized a full investigation which resulted in the expelling of more than 100 homosexuals from Brooklyn Bethel. At the same time, Knorr gave specific instructions to cover up the scandal. But why was Nathan Knorr so tolerant to homosexuals inside Jehovah's Witnesses? Well, according to his own wife, Nathan Knorr had homosexual tendencies, when she confided to a couple of their friendship that Knorr never consummated their marriage. When Nathan Knorr died in 1977, his wife was still virgin, which made her look forward to remarry some years again. This is also a disqualification issue, once the Bible instructs that in 1 Corinthians 7-3, that the husband should give to his wife her due. It seems that Knorr failed on that matter during several years and exposed his wife to temptation all along that period. After all these scandals, we are not surprised that the Watchtower magazine, published by the 1st of January 1986, stated that, shocking as it is, even some who have been prominent in Jehovah's organization have succumbed to immoral practices, including homosexuality, wife swapping, and child molesting. Please take note that those figures which we mentioned were not only regular members of the governing body, but they also had strong responsibilities within the organization. For example, Leo Kincaid Greenlees was a zone overseer, traveling all around the world on behalf of the governing body, but he was also member of the teaching committee. Both him and Hewitt Chitty were part of the powerful financial department, which according to Professor Fritz Springmeier had strong links to the powerful elites of the world, such as the Rothschilds, the Rockefellers, and the Morgans. On the other hand, Theodore Jarach was the one who had to be removed from the Australian branch under secrecy, to whom there were several live accusations for child sex abuse, including ritual abuse. His victims were usually silenced and despised, many times treated as DIS fellowships, despite not given any reasons for it. Pat Garza, for example, died of cancer by 2003 after she took public the sexual abuses she suffered from Jarach. She was completely abandoned by the congregation, despite all those accusations. Jarach was assigned as the head of the powerful service department and was also member of the teaching committee of the governing body. He was so powerful and influential in the Watchtower Society that he barred Harry Poloyan of becoming a helper to the governing body, despite him being a senior writer to the Watchtower and some of the most respected voices inside Brooklyn Bethel. He was also the driving force behind the disfellowshipping of Barbara Anderson, mostly because she raised concerns about the increasing number of cases of child sex abuse from high officials in the Watchtower Society and Jarach's intentions of a cover-up on all cases. Today, the Watchtower is paying a high price in their reputation and in their bank account, having to dispose of hundreds of millions of dollars in compensation and court settlements.